And all this is part of your life as an unsaved person, without even a tinge of conscience about the things you're doing. Now, that's a lost person. Doesn't even think about it. There's no sense of guilt or anything like that. He is technically guilty, but doesn't feel it, doesn't experience it. Until God begins to do a work in his life, he either hears the gospel or is in the presence of other Christians who are praying for him, and somehow God's Spirit begins moving in his life and begins being convicted of his wrongdoing and convicted of the fact that he needs Jesus Christ. Now, all that takes place, and you've experienced that if you know Christ. You've been through that. You know how you were before you were a Christian, and now that you are a believer, how things are different. But one day, that lost person, who is so full of sin and full of wrong, and everything is going the wrong direction, something happens and he gets saved. A miracle of God occurs, and it's not something he did himself. He didn't just say some words and or come forward and sign a pledge. No, he put his full trust in Jesus Christ, and everything changed in that person's life. He desires now in his life to obey God. He desires in his life to honor Jesus as his Savior because he's in his heart and life. And all that Jesus did, he realizes it. He has the desire to do these things, and spiritual growth begins to occur in his life. Time goes by. Most of all those pre-Christ wrongs he set aside and left, but there's something he starts to notice in his life, and some of you perhaps do this as well. Notice that some of those before-Christ issues start cropping back. Some of the things that you've put aside, you thought, when you came to Christ. They're sort of coming back. Anger, resentment. Some habits you never considered going back to, just sort of start going back to them. Pulling you back towards those things. How in the world do I, as a Christian, because I'm a believer now, and I'm not obligated to that stuff I used to do, how do I find victory over those sins that so easily entangle us? We're believers now. And many of us have good intentions. Oh, I really want to follow the Lord. I really want to do the right thing, but I keep slipping back and going back to those old ways. Those besetting sins, they keep me back from honoring God. Some of you, perhaps, that sin is timidity, fear of sharing the gospel, maybe shyness and talking to somebody else about Christ. We all seem to have that. Others, oh, I'm a believer, but you know, I just lack a solid commitment. I'll start coming to quality church, and then things of the world start pulling me away, and I just get interested in other things. Or some of you say in your hearts, well, I don't really need any change. I'm satisfied like I am because that's just the way I am. And somehow we get content with thinking, well, that's just the way I am. That's my habits, not my life. Yeah, I was like that before a Christian. I'm just doing it now. That's just the way I am. It's never going to change. Now, all those attitudes are wrong because it's not us changing, but it's the Spirit of God changing us through Christ. And this message today, and the messages that will follow in a few Sundays here, are designed for saved people. I want to say that. I don't apologize for you for that, but it's designed for people who are already saved. You know for sure that you have Christ as your Savior. Not designed for unsaved people. If you're lost, if you've never come to Jesus and put your trust and faith in Him, you're not going to understand much of what we're saying. You're going to think it's a bunch of rules or it's a bunch of things that make no sense to you. The main reason is because there is a distinct difference between a person who has Christ in his heart and a person who does not have Christ. And there are spiritual things, understandings that a person with Christ can understand because his heart is open to those things and they become a reality to him. And it's nothing saying bad about you, because take notes on it. Someday when Christ moves in your heart and you do trust in him, this will be helpful for you. Because coming to Christ is not just reciting a prayer. It's not just signing up on a membership card and say, yeah, I want to do that and be baptized, because I feel like it's time. No, it's a moving of Christ in your heart. You have believed on him. Now read with me, if you would. Ephesians chapter 4, beginning with verse 22. Speaking of this fact, that ye put off concerning the former conversation or lifestyle of the old man, which is corrupt according to the deceitful lusts, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind, and that ye put on the new man, which after God is created in righteousness and true holiness. Paul's saying here that we're going to put something off. In fact, there are three simple commands here. He's talking to believers, by the way. In fact, we didn't read the verse, but look up at verse 21. Paul is talking to believers here, which is us. If so, that ye have heard him. What does that mean? It means heard him, Jesus. You hear Jesus. Well, you respond, you obey. And having been taught by him, instruction from Jesus, the truth is in Jesus. So he's speaking to folks who are believers, who've heard him, who've been taught by him, who understand these spiritual concepts. Three simple commands that Paul gives us here to illustrate the way to experience a truly transformed life as a Christian. Now you can say, oh, I'm a believer, oh yes, I'm a Christian. I made that decision 30, 40 years ago, and I'm just the way I am. Or you can say, I want to be more like Jesus. I want that experience of being a changed, transformed person, because I've heard that when you're a Christian, everything's different. And to me, nothing seemed to change. Well, listen to what he says here. Three commands that are put off, put on, and renewed. Very simple. That's in different order in the text, but we'll get to that. First of all, verse 22, Paul says, put off the old man, the old nature. He says to set aside the old way of life, because when you were lost, everything in your life, everything that revolved around you, you were a lost, unsaved person, and you were centered on yourself. He says, set that aside. The word, the verb there is apotithemi. It means to throw off, to cast off, to take off, like you take a garment off, to be done with that old man. And literally the old man, I know some translations don't use the word man, but it is actually the word anthropos, which we get our word man from. The old anthropos, the old man. Now, it's an image, it's a picture, it's a metaphor to describe what we were like before becoming a Christian. And what was that life like? It was corrupt, he says. Look, read verse 22 here. The former way of life, which is corrupt, in other words, rotting, ruined, it means destruction, seduction, all these things of that life before you were a believer happened. And the interesting thing is you never even noticed it. You never knew it was something that was something you ought to put off. It's just like a garment which you take off. And I'm going to do something here. I don't usually do this on Sunday morning, but I'm going to take off my jacket here. I put on something I brought with me. This was in my basement, and it's pretty dirty. It's got dust, and probably a lot of mildew, and I'm going to probably put it on here. I don't stink. It doesn't have another dress. You're far enough away, you have to smell it. Anyway, this is a picture, you might say, of that old nature. It's an old jacket, old coat. You'll notice something's missing on it. Most of the sleeve has been cut away. It's dirty. I can tell you the truth, it's got dust all over it, and I'm probably getting it all for me now. But I don't even notice it. I'll think about it. In fact, I'm quite proud of it. In my heart and my mind, I'm thinking, this is just fine. This is my life. And it's according to the lust and deceit, this deceptive desire that I have. It's the things that I want, and I don't even think about them being something wrong. It's an unsaved life. And this represents or reflects my life as a lost person. It is the old man. And Paul says to put it off, to take it off. But as a lost person, I have no interest in taking it off because it's mine, it's fine. It may look bad to you. You notice right away that something's wrong with it. But I don't. Because it's me, my personality. It's all about me because it's my nature as a person without Christ. Sin infiltrates this just like dirt infiltrates this coat. And it's just totally that way. The best way to describe this, turn back in your Bibles for just a second. The 1 Corinthians, gotta go back to the left for a second. 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 45. I just want to read this to you so you see how this picture is pictured, really, because what I'm doing here, wearing this old filthy jacket, is exactly what Paul's talking about when he speaks about the earthly or the fleshly person, the natural man, the man who is without Christ. So it is written, the first man, Adam, was a living soul. The last Adam was made a quivering spirit. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 46. Howbeit that was not first which is spiritual, but that which is natural. Afterward, that which is spiritual. The first man is of the earth. Earthy. What does that mean? It means as filthy as his garment is, he's earthy. The second man is the Lord from heaven. As is the earthy, such also are they which are of earthy. And as is the heavenly, such as they also are the heavenly. And as we have borne the image of the earthy, we shall also bear the image of the heavenly. What is that simply saying? There's a difference. There's a contrast, a sharp contrast between someone who is saved and someone who is lost, because a lost person can wear a garment like this and enjoy it, be proud of it, not take it off because it's all about him. And it's a sinful garment. Paul writes in Romans 6:6 this very word. He says, knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. Sin is the nature of a garment. Paul says, take it off. Get rid of it. Because they're deceptive desires with it. Let me ask you a question. This lust of deceit, this idea of the desire of something that is really deceitful. Have you ever wanted something so much that when you finally got it, you weren't happy with it? Think about that. The something you got, maybe it was a toy as a child, or maybe a car as a young person. You craved and you desired so much. And when you got it, you weren't happy. It might have been a material possession. It might have been a personal relationship with someone else. If you wanted to be a friend of that person, you strove that person, and that person turned you away. Or maybe it's a marital situation, a partner that turned you away. And all the things you sought for in that person or that thing, when it came to be, it evaporated. It wasn't what you thought it would be. That's why one of the greatest quotes I've heard is the happiest day of a man's life is the day he buys the boat. The second happiest day is the day he sells the boat. Because all that boat is his trouble and work. And he thinks it's going to be so wonderful, and it turns out not to be that. Well, when you're desiring something so much, you realize it's not as desirable sometimes as I thought it would be. It's empty. And that's what deceit does. That's what this corruption does in the life of a believer when he goes and hangs around the old garment. Paul says, put it off. Take it off. Just like you take a piece of clothing off. Get rid of it. Put it off and set it aside. This is what I'm going to do right now. And shake the dust off of me from that. But that's not all I do, because that's the first step. The second is, in verse 24, it says to then put on something. Put on something else. Put on a new coat. In this case, bought a new coat a few weeks ago. So I'm going to slip this on and it fits better. It's clean. It doesn't stink. It's a nice jacket. Of course, I don't need it on a day like today, but in cold weather, man, this is great. And you don't notice this missing a sleeve or any of those things. In fact, it is. It just sort of suits me because it has been put on, it's being worn, and it's a new thing. In this case, a new man. Again, that clear contrast between being saved and being unsaved. And this new garment, it says here in verse 24, has been made or created in righteousness and true holiness. It's what God wants for me. In fact, not only does it help me, it glorifies God as I wear this new garment for Him. This is the new man. This is the new person in Christ. And the word is enduo. That simply means to put on, like you'd wear a garment. And now this new garment has been made righteous, holy. And the thing is, the one who wears this new garment has been transformed too. It's not just the garment, but the person who is inside the garment has been changed. It has a spiritual effect in his life, different from a coat, of course. An image or a picture can only take illustration so far, but what the new covenant does, it changes my heart, changes me. Listen to what Paul writes in 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things are passed away, behold, all things become new. The fact that I've got this new garment on, I become a new person. I see things differently. I don't want to go back to the way I was in that old garment. He says in Galatians 2:20, I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. You see, you want to change, you want to become a new person, put on a new garment. That's what happens. By giving your heart and life to Jesus Christ, it says, put it on, you will be changed. But how does one keep from going back? Now here we have a new garment. Nice, clean, smells good. It's a godly thing, it's a righteous thing, and I find myself slowly going back and notice that old coat that I used to have. There's still a lot of good in it. There's some leather on it. I can get to take advantage. And that's the same thing we do as Christians, don't we? We start thinking, well, I had it good back in the old days. And I had fun. I remember the drinking days with my buddies, and I remember. And we start going back, we start picking a few things off of here. Might be good. That nice fleece feels good. And we think in our minds, well, if I just have that, and that's our downfall. And I discovered something in this passage. It was a great discovery. How in the world do we keep from going back to that old coat and desiring? Or even worse, putting it back on. And that's the case that a lot of Christians say, I'll just put the old nature back on and go back to that thing. I discovered in this passage some interesting things in the original text. Each of these verses, these three verses, starts with a verb. Now, I realize in English you don't see it that way. They didn't really worry about the order in those days, but each starts with a verb, and each of those verbs is an infinitive. That doesn't mean anything to you either. Except the fact that those verbs end up being commands. He's commanding us in each of these verses, and we skipped a verse, if you notice, in verse 23. And that's the third important thing. And actually, it's the answer to our question. How do I keep from going back? Verse 23, renewed the spirit of your mind. And that's a command. Look what it says. And be renewed in the spirit of your mind. The key to a lasting change in your walk and my walk with Christ is a transformed mind. Or a thought life. It's not just your brain in there. It's your whole thought life. It's the Greek word ananeo, which means to renew, to make something new. You see, becoming a Christian is not just mouthing some words. You want to become a Muslim, you just say some words, and you become a Muslim. Easy to get in, hard to get out. As a Christian, you don't just say words. It's not just signing a membership card. No, it's an exchange of an old sinful life and style of life and taking upon yourself in humble submission a brand new life. And along with that life, a beginning of a process of changing what's in here in your mind. And when you begin having that mind change, you'll discover that if it's a mind that's according to Christ and is a blessing to Him, you will be blessed. So the question is, how do we change your mind? What do we have when we have this changed mind? If our minds are to be renewed by God, by His Spirit working in us, what exactly would that mind look like? What exactly is our thought life going to look like? Let me suggest some things. There are at least six changes or characteristics of a mind that has been changed by Jesus. What is our thought life to be in order to maintain the freshness? Always wearing that new cloak. Always wearing the new garment as a new man. How is that going to continue on a regular basis? Let me suggest these things. First of all, a mind that is open to and submissive to spiritual truth. That mind that you have that has now been changed, if you let it drift, it'll drift right back to that old jacket, that old way of life. But you need to have a mind that is open to and submissive to scriptural and spiritual truth. Romans 8:6-7 says, "For to be carnally minded is death, But to be spiritually minded is life and peace, because the carnal mind is enmity against God. It's just that simple. We need to be open to spiritual truth. Secondly, our minds need to be our minds that exhibit lowliness and humility toward God. Colossians 3:12, Paul writes, "Therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, put on tender mercies, kindness, humility, meekness, and longsuffering." He says in Romans 12:3, a very famous verse, "For I say, through the grace given unto me, to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, according as God hath dealt to every man the measure of faith." Don't think of yourself as great. Don't think of yourself with pride. That's the old way. Exhibiting humility. Thirdly, a minds that have the mind of Christ. That's a double word there, but you get the idea. Having the mind of Christ. Philippians 2:5 says, "Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus." 1 Corinthians 2:16 says, "But we have the mind of Christ." When you recognize that what goes on in your brain is actually the mind of Christ working in you because you're yielding to Him, it makes a difference in how you see things. It makes a difference in what you do, because your mind has been His mind. Fourth, mind that maintains unity with other believers. Unity with other believers. In other words, other people, other Christians are important to you. Philippians 2:2 says, "Fulfill my joy by being like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord, of one mind." 1 Peter 3:8 says, "Finally, all of you be of one mind, having compassion for one another, love as brothers, be tender-hearted, be courteous." You know, when my mind is Christ's mind, when it becomes a mind controlled by Him, I want to be kind and loving to my fellow believers. Fifthly, it's a mind centered on purity and goodness. I don't have to remind you of Philippians 4:8. Paul writes, "Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are good, report, if there be any virtue and if anything of praise, think on these things." That's what our mind needs to be, on those pure things. Centered on purity, goodness, and joy. And then finally, a mind that is filled with Scripture. Our minds are like a holding tank. And what we put in it comes out. And what we fill our minds with honors God. And when we do that, 2 Peter 3:1 says, "I stir up your pure minds by way of remembrance, that you may be mindful of the words which were spoken before the holy prophets and of the commandment of us, the apostles, the Lord and Savior." The message from the apostles is God's Scripture. They wrote it down. They put it out there. You say to yourself, "Well, that's interesting, but I think I already have a mind. I think it's mine." No, let it be Christ's mind. Because the mind, as we wear the garment of holiness, the garment of righteousness, the garment of Christ, changes us, but it needs to change our mind. Because our garment reflects His glory. Our minds, His thoughts, are so key. Now, next time we get together, we're going to talk about things like how to star sin. That's what's so key about this too. How to kill and put to death sin in our life. But for right now, the important thing is what's our mind on? What do we need to do to work on this thought life in our minds? Paul writes in Romans 12, "I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercy of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is good, acceptable, and perfect will of God." Renewed minds? How can that ever happen? As you yield the Holy Spirit. As you ask God to speak to your heart and mind. To give you that mind that would honor Him. As you glorify Christ. Would you bow with me in prayer? Our Heavenly Father, we give you thanks today that we have a new life in Christ. we have a garment of righteousness in Christ. And we don't need to go back to that old man, that old nature, that old way that we came out of. But our tendency as believers, as humans, is to do so. Lord, we need your mind. We need your thought life, your thought patterns, your minds. Give us your scripture. Teach us, Lord, that our minds might not just say, oh yes, I acknowledge that, but I'm just the way I am. Lord, that a transformation might take place. Each and every day we say, I want my life to glorify Christ. I want my mind, my thought life to be the starting place in that adventure. So thank you, Lord. Teach us, Father, as you have done today, how to walk with you in faith because of our Savior, Lord Jesus. Now, there may be somebody here today that has been praying about it, that God has been convicting them, directing them to turn their life over to Jesus. Right now, in the quietness of your heart, if that's the case with you, would you just say to him, Lord, I'm a sinner. The garment of sin is all over my life. But I want to put it off. I want to take it off. I want Christ to come and be my Savior. I want that new life, that new garment that is Jesus come in my life. Make that your prayer. He hears you. He knows. Turn away from sin. Turn only to Jesus and Christ alone. Maybe you're already a believer and you've been praying by the church home and God has been speaking to your heart about this place. We receive in any way we receive members, whether it's transfer or by baptism. You do as God speaks to you in your heart right now. And tell him. Father, we thank you. Help us to make public that which we just privately done in our hearts. To find new life. Just let that new life be seen in us. Which in Jesus' name we do pray. Amen.